Good morning. My name is Kenneth Davis. I'm from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. I'm the Alabama coordinator for MS Views and News, and I'd like to welcome you to the 2015 MS Symposium here in Atlanta. Today, we're going to have a good time. It's a nice, gorgeous day, and we thank you for coming out. I'd like to mention a couple of things about our website. First thing, if you'll notice on the website that's up on the screen, the left-hand side of that, you'll see the blue YouTube link. On that YouTube link, you can enjoy all the past programs. There's over 100 different programs that's been done throughout Florida, Alabama, North Carolina, and the states that we're expanding in. Also, you'll find on the right-hand side a link to the registration page. That is where you can go and register for the events and also see future events. One future event you'll be interested in is our Sandy Springs event coming up October the 14th. And after that, that's about it for me. I'm going to let Stuart take over from here.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Thank you for coming. Isn't this a great day? And you know, Ken talks about it being beautiful weather outside. We prefer when it's raining, because then you have nothing to do and you want to come to our programs, right? So that's what we want you to do. You know, Ken mentioned about the video recordings. We have over 180 recordings out on our YouTube channel. And if you want to go to our YouTube channel, it's pretty easy. You could go to our website, and at the top of the page, there's that site there that says blogs and video. You click on that and a drop-down box comes and you can find our YouTube channel easily right there. And again, it's 180 videos of like everything that you want to know about multiple sclerosis. You can find it there, all right? If you don't find it there, then you can call your doctor like Dr. Thrower and yell at him and tell him it's not there. Ask him why it's not there and he could talk to me about it, all right? But, you know, we do these things though because we do programs now in 10 states. I mean, the last time I saw a lot of you in this room, we were only doing programs in 5 states. And maybe the first time we were here in Atlanta, we were only doing programs in Florida and Atlanta, and that was it. And that was only 5 years ago, okay? So this is how we are evolving. We're doing programs now in 10 states. Today's program is our 36th program of this year, 9 remaining for this year. That gives us 45. How many weeks are in the year, guys? 45 programs. When am I sleeping? Thank you. So before I get further into anything, I don't want to take up a lot of time here. I do want to thank those. We have volunteers that help us with all our programs. Outside this room, you saw at the registration table, we have 2 young ladies. Young ladies. I have to call everybody young ladies or I get in trouble, all right? But one is from right here in Temple, Georgia, and that's Elizabeth Carpenter. And Elizabeth will be at the Sandy Springs program with our social worker who's going to be at that program from Florida. I will not be at that program, everybody. I can't be at all 45, all right? But our social worker from Florida will be there. Elizabeth will be there. And we also have at the registration table today, Michelle Markman, who came up from Florida to help out with this program. Then you also just met Ken, and Ken's wife, Susan, is out there. And they're expanding, helping us expand in Alabama, which is like where we wanted. There's so many unmet needs everywhere, but we can only pick one place. And this guy jumped out of the ring several years ago, and he said, I want to help make it happen. So I thank Ken, and I hope you all appreciate a person like Ken. Thank you. Then there are others that are here today as well, but I can't remember everybody. We have Vicki Pomeroy. Vicki, a lot of you all know, and Julie Werner. They came down to help too, so I want to thank them. Then, of course, we have to thank those that enable us to do these programs, and that's the pharmaceutical industry. And yes, the pharmaceutical industry does back MS Views and News. They do back other MS organizations as well. We personally cannot do these types of programs without them helping us to do these programs. And so for today's program, I, and I hope all of you do too, will appreciate that Genzyme, a Sanofi company, gave us the funding to do this, today's program, and I gotta say thank you to them. In addition to Genzyme, Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals, who makes the Acthar Gel, okay? And that's for for MS relapse. You'll probably hear about that today from one of our two great speakers that are here. And again, you know, Dr. Ben Thrower and Tracy Walker, one of them will be talking about it. Also to thank is Acorda Therapeutics, because Acorda, who makes the Empira, the walking pill, is today's sponsor of our Continental Breakfast, because you all couldn't eat that today if we didn't have them and their sponsorship dollars. So let's thank them too. The agenda for today's program, you probably have somewhere on your table. If it's not on your table and you really need to know what's on today's agenda, go steal it from another table. All right, next up we have doctor, this is an attorney. I'll get sued for saying doctor. All right, his name is Mark Biernath, and he's here to give a presentation that's gonna greatly affect the caregivers. And then after Mark gives his presentation, we'll do a short Q&A. And then at the very end, we have Kristie Salerno, who's a patient, advocate, speaker, who's gonna talk about her MS journey. Okay, so again, everybody, please hold down all your chatter. I don't wanna have to go around and shush everybody. I hate doing that, okay? So please hold down your chatter, all right? And then we'll get to hear this presentation. Thank you.
You're gonna be able to Thank you, Stuart. My name is Mark Biernath. I'm an attorney here in the Atlanta area that does a lot of special needs work, a lot of special needs law. Some refer to it as disability law. And so I don't do Social Security appeals and Social Security applications. I know enough to be dangerous, but I know people who know the answers to that kind of stuff. You know, so I'll be able to answer basic questions about that, but, you know, kind of detailed questions about that probably be better with an actual Social Security disability attorney. Before I get started here, I am an attorney, so I have to make certain disclosures and disclaimers. This meeting and discussion is for educational purposes only and does not, nor should be construed as legal advice. Want to know how I know that? Most people say we're not paying you, but it's actually because I just told you this is not legal advice. I'm gonna be talking in general terms. I'm gonna be talking about what the law generally provides. It may not apply to your specific situation. So this does not substitute for sitting down with an attorney to discuss your specific situation, your specific goals, and what's the best way to meet those goals. This is a little bit of information about my partner, Heather. She's not here today, but we work on these types of matters together. And sometimes we do the presentation together. And here's me. I'm a member of all kinds of things that lawyers tend to be members of. To me, the most important line on that slide is the bottom line. I am married, I have a wife named Krista, I have a daughter named Kelsey, and have a critter named Sophie. This is my wife, she's the one in the middle, in case you are wondering. And I'm also disclosing where my loyalties lie in this state. I know we're outnumbered at least 4-1, but you know, I root for my team. But my wife has, you might notice, some disabilities. She has something called neurofibromatosis type 2. Anybody ever hear of that? It actually works almost the opposite of what multiple sclerosis does. Instead of the myelin of the fibers breaking down, her myelin builds up and it forms tumors. End result's essentially the same, the nerve doesn't work anymore. And so she has gotten worse over the last couple of years. I also have some issues myself. You might see me pushing around my brand new rollator, I guess is what they call them. I had been using a cane or a crutch for about 2 years, but after several falls this summer, my doctor decided I needed something a little bigger and a little sturdier. So I'm learning how to use that. They thought I had MS about 10 years ago. They kept scanning my brain and not finding any issues with it, and so they couldn't really figure out what it was. About 5 years ago, I passed out at my daughter's doctor's office, and the doctor said that wasn't right, your heart stopped, it was not good, you need to be worked up. So they did a complete workup, and they discovered my head is not on straight. My Exactly. My soccer coach always said it, that my head wasn't on right. Now I have an MRI to prove it. I have something called atlanto-occipital assimilation. Congenitally, I do not have a C1 vertebrae, so all the head motion is transferred to the rest of my neck, resulting in spinal cord stenosis, and I've got reduced blood flow to my cerebellum and all this kind of stuff. So a lot of the medications that they were talking about earlier, I'm very familiar with those. And many side effects that go along with those medications, I'm very familiar with. So listening to the listing of symptoms that MS patients have, I'm like, I'm very familiar with all that. Basically, I hibernate in the summer. I can't get out in the heat. If I do, bad things happen. So, but that's a little bit about kind of how I got into this area of law. This is my daughter. And now we're really going to disclose that my family has won the genetic lottery. My daughter has something called Turner syndrome. Anybody familiar with that? She's only got one X chromosome. So that she got the one with the shopping gene on it, so she's going to be just fine. She's actually a senior at the University of Minnesota. Hopefully she'll be graduating this spring and then go to grad school and become a licensed teacher up in Minnesota. But that's what got me into this whole area of law. My family kind of lives this, and so I decided, first I started out in special education law. From there, moved into special needs trust, special needs estate planning, and guardianship work, which I think is why Stuart asked me to come speak today, is my work in guardianship issues. And so that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. Oh, by the way, this is Sophie. She's the critter. Now, I'm a lawyer, and lawyers get to see sometimes the worst things that happen. And I've got stories that will curl your toes and make your skin crawl, and you know, I can tell you stories that are going to scare you. But the fact is, not everything that can happen will happen. You know, so there's a realm of possibility. And you want to be aware of the different kind of legal issues that are possible. But more importantly, I want you to focus on those areas that are probable, those things that are likely to happen. And then, of course, there are certain things that are inevitable. Now, as an estate planning attorney, what do you think I think is inevitable? Death and taxes. And we can now deal with most of the taxes. You know, so everybody needs to address the estate planning issues. But there's an area of estate planning that often gets neglected. You know, everybody's thinking, okay, estate planning is dealing with death. But there's this period of time where you may not be able to function for yourself, but you're not dead. You're still alive. And so what we're going to talk about today is, what about that period of time? What about that period of time where I'm still here, but I need somebody to be able to make decisions for me? And so when it comes to talking about empowering the caregiver, I think that's the title of my talk here. What I'm talking about is making sure your caregiver, if you are the caregiver, that you have the legal authority to make decisions that need to be made. Because if you don't currently have someone who can make decisions for you, and you can't do it anymore, your family may have to go in front of a judge and ask permission to make those decisions. Now, what course of action you take will depend on when does the incapacitating condition begin. And I'm looking around the room, and though most of the women are somewhere in their 20s, I would suggest that everybody is over the age of 18. So I'm going to assume that who we're talking about is already over the age of 18. And over the age of 18, we have options. If the incapacity starts before age 18, we have very few options. So we're going to talk about the advanced planning techniques, the powers of attorney, and trusts. And then I'm also going to talk about guardianship and conservatorships so that you understand what happens if you don't do the advanced planning. And my goal there is to hopefully encourage you to do the advanced planning. So by empowering the caregiver, I mean Who has the ability to make decisions? What kind of decisions can they make? And one thing that you have to understand, and this is a tough one, when you empower somebody to make decisions for you, they have the duty to make the decisions you would want them to make. And you know, with my wife, I was her primary caregiver for 15 years. She's now in a skilled nursing facility. Her condition got to the point where she needed additional help, more help than I could do. We had caregivers in the house. We had caregivers during the day, then we went to 24-hour caregivers, and then finally after the fourth nursing agency said, look, the only way this is gonna work is if we pay for two CNAs, 24 hours a day, plus two skilled nursing visits a day. You know, that adds up pretty quick. And basically the only option for us was to look at skilled nursing. And my wife, she's from Illinois. She came down here. She's a developmental pediatrician. She came down here to work at Emory and then at the CDC. She had always decided that if she had to go into skilled nursing, she wanted to go back to Illinois, which is where her parents are. They can visit with her every day, and she's got friends up there that visit with her weekly. And so I try to go up once a month to visit with her. So I'm still responsible for coordinating her care, but we've kind of delegated how those decisions are being made. But I have the duty to make the decisions she would make, not what I would make for myself. And that's an important distinction to make. And over the years, I mean, we've been in the hospital where the hospice team comes in and is asking me to make decisions. And I know what I would have decided, but I also know what my wife wanted. And so, you know, we made those decisions. Now, how did I have the authority to make those decisions? And that's, my wife has executed powers of attorney. What is a power of attorney? It's a document that simply allows your agent, that's the person who's being empowered, to act on behalf of the principal. That's the person who's granting the power. And that can be done, you know, you can do a power of attorney if you're just not around, if you're not available, or if you're incapacitated. And frequently, people will use a power of attorney, say, to sell a house. You know, they may have already moved across the country. They still had a piece of property here in Georgia. They finally got an offer on it. They're selling it. They don't want to fly back to Atlanta just to close on the house. So they'll sign a power of attorney and let their real estate agent close on the house for them. But the one where it's if you're incapacitated, there we're going to use a much broader power of attorney to basically do anything that I can do. So these powers of attorney can address financial decisions, or they can address healthcare decisions. In order to do a power of attorney, it must be your independent choice. I work with a lot of families with the developmentally disabled, and when those kids turn into adults, a lot of parents just want their child to sign a power of attorney. Well, that's nice, convenient, easy, and simple. But if I'm putting that document in front of that individual and they're going to sign whatever I put in front of them, it's not really their independent choice, now is it? Someone else is telling them to do it. Someone else is directing them to do it. So you have to have the ability to make an independent choice. Powers of attorney do not actually have to be in writing, but I challenge anyone to prove that a power of attorney exists without it being in writing. So even though the law does not require it be in writing, it has to be in writing. Some of the powers have to be notarized. I know certain powers dealing with real estate, dealing with taxes, we need to have that power notarized. So we always want to have a notary sign financial powers of attorney. And that's one of those kind of balancing points that if the notary doesn't believe the person knows what they're doing, the notary is not supposed to notarize that document. Because part of what the notarization is for is to say, this was this person's independent act and they were the ones that actually signed it. And you must have capacity. And the definition of capacity differs county to county. I believe we have 146 counties here in Georgia. So we actually have 146 different definitions of capacity. And when we get to how the guardianship process works, I'll explain what that means. But generally, what does it mean to have capacity? First thing is, you must be over the age of 18. Everybody under the age of 18 legally is incapacitated. We all knew it. It's actually in the law. But when you turn 18, you magically have capacity, whether you actually do or not. You must have the ability to make and or communicate significant responsible decisions concerning your health, safety, welfare, and finances. And by finances, I mean the management of your property. So that's the general rule, but how that rule gets applied is up to each individual probate court in each individual county in this state. So that's why I say there are 146 different definitions of capacity in Georgia. The probate judge gets to make that determination, and they make it on a case-by-case basis. Every time that question comes to the court, they have to take evidence, and then the judge has to decide each case individually. Now, I propose that every adult, everyone over the age of 18, should have an advanced directive for health care. When my daughter turned 18, I had a document in front of her at the restaurant where we were celebrating her birthday. And I said, you need to name who you want making healthcare decisions for you if you can't do it for yourself. And so she wrote those names down, and then she signed it, and we had some witnesses witness it. But in the Advanced Directive for Healthcare, this is a statutory form. So you don't even have to go to a lawyer to get this thing. The legislature wrote this form for you. And in the slides, I've got the website where you can get it. But in this document, you can nominate up to three people to make decisions for you. Now, it does not work as a committee. It's one after the other. So you have a primary, then if they can't do it, somebody, and then if they can't do it, somebody. Total of three. And in this power of attorney, you can also indicate certain preferences regarding end-of-life type decisions. Now, if you're ever admitted to a hospital in Georgia, they're going to ask, do you have a living will? Georgia technically no longer has a document called a living will. What they're actually asking is, do you have an advanced directive for healthcare? About 5 years ago now, the legislature merged the two documents, the living will and the healthcare power of attorney, because there was a lot of confusion between the two. And in some cases, people were making choices in one document which were directly opposite of the choices that seemed to be reflected in the other document, creating a lot of confusion. You know, a doctor or a hospital would receive these documents and look at them and go, we don't know what they want. And so the legislature decided to make it a little easier, streamline it a bit, and just combine it all into one document. And it's much more user-friendly. The old document had a double negative in it. I do not want. Well, what exactly does that mean? So it eliminated some of those issues. And now in the Advanced Directive for Healthcare, you get to express certain things about body donation, donating organs, burial, cremation, those kind of issues. And also what used to be called a living will is now in there. Now, Georgia doesn't get very fancy with their living will. It applies only to two conditions. First one being if you're diagnosed with a terminal condition, and the other one being you're in a state of permanent unconsciousness. And those are medically defined, and then you can tell the doctors, hey, doctors, I want you to do everything possible to keep me alive for as long as possible. Or you can say, allow my natural death to occur. I don't want any medications, machines, or procedures that are going to keep me alive but not cure me, including I don't want nutrition by feeding tube or hydration by IV. But then at the end of B, it says, except as needed to provide pain medication. Pain medication is always, legally always supposed to be provided. And then the third option, there's kind of a combination. So, but every adult should have one of those. Whether you have a known disease course or condition that might eventually render you incapacitated or not, because the fact is, I believe it's now 80% of us will spend some period of time of your life not being able to make decisions for yourself. The other document that I strongly recommend people have is a durable financial power of attorney. Now, this, there is a statutory form, but I actually suggest not to use it simply because financial institutions tend to not accept it. But in a durable financial power of attorney, you can nominate as many people as you want to be agents. You can even name them as committees if you want. I would not suggest doing so, but you could. But in it, you're basically designating people who can manage your financial life. And we want that power of attorney to be something that's called durable. And what that means is, if I become incapacitated, ordinarily under the law of agency or under the law of powers of attorneys, the power of attorney would terminate if I became incapacitated. But if we put a specific clause in the document that says, even if I'm incapacitated, I still want this power of attorney to be effective, that makes it durable. And that's why we want to have that. Now, we have a problem here in Georgia. And that problem is, well, we have lots of problems in Georgia. But the problem I'm specifically referring to here is the power of attorney may not be honored by a financial institution. We do not have a law that requires anyone to accept powers of attorney. And so you might show up at Wells Fargo with your power of attorney and they say, no. And there's really nothing you can do about it. We have had some success arguing with the legal counsel at Wells Fargo or at Charles Schwab, but very frequently we do run into problems. And then we may have no other alternative than to do what I'm going to be discussing in a few minutes. But the more precise, the more descriptive the power of attorney is, the more likely it will be accepted. And that's why in Georgia, you will see powers of attorney that are 30 pages long. Whereas in other states, there are about 30 states now that have a law that say, hey, financial institution, you must accept the power of attorney. And then you get away with the statutory power of attorney, which is about a page and a half, 2 pages long. And basically says, hey, anything I can do, my agent can do. So we don't have that law. And it's a consumer protection, we don't have that law. In the states that require financial institutions to accept the power of attorney, the burden of accepting that power of attorney shifts from the financial institution to the person who presented the power of attorney. So, a power of attorney allows somebody to access your bank accounts. And somebody with a power of attorney might show up at Wells Fargo and say, oop, I need to take all this money out of the account and move it over to this other account. And, you know, right now, Wells Fargo would say, no, not here in Georgia, you won't. But in another state, they'll say, okay, you have a power of attorney, you can do that. And then you come back from your, you know, weekend vacation down at Destin, and you discover all your money's gone. And you go to Wells Fargo and say, hey, what'd you do with my money? And they say, oh, well, somebody presented a power of attorney, we gave it to them. Here in Georgia, I get to sue Wells Fargo. In those other states, you have to sue the person who presented the power of attorney. So I know where Wells Fargo is, and I know Wells Fargo has a lot of money. So I feel pretty confident that I'm going to recover what was taken from me. But in those other states, I'm not so confident. A, can I find that person? And B, if I can, does he still have the money? Probably not. So it is a consumer protection. We have this here in Georgia, but it does create problems for planning for incapacity. So here are the limitations of a power of attorney. Powers of attorney don't remove any rights. When I grant a power of attorney, I can still make all my own decisions. But I'm giving someone else the ability to make decisions also. I can't disavow or void contracts. So let's say I'm in a period of time where I'm not doing so well. I might feel depressed, hopeless, and I just start giving assets away. It happens. With a power of attorney, you can't stop that. You know, if you've got a loved one who's giving away all the family heirlooms, giving away stuff, a power of attorney won't stop them from doing that. The court procedure that I'm going to talk about, we can't actually stop that. powers of attorney can be revoked. And all it can take is someone telling their doctor, "Doctor, I don't want you talking to that person anymore." And then they have to stop talking to that person. That's, in effect, a revocation of the power of attorney. And we often see this in mental health cases. So, you know, when mental health issues are a concern, that's where we start seeing these kinds of things. And like I said, nobody in Georgia has to accept a power of attorney, so it might not be honored. Now, even with all these limitations, you still need to do these things, because more often than not, it is going to be helpful. And also, having a power of attorney is evidence of capacity. That can be a problem if we have to go to court and prove incapacity. So, we're going to start talking about what the state of Georgia's plan for your incapacity is. Emergency situations are treated differently than a chronic or a routine situation. If you are involved in an automobile accident and the EMTs arrive on scene and you are unconscious, they do not have to find somebody to give them permission to treat you. The law provides this thing called the doctrine of implied consent, which means the legislature just simply decided everybody is going to accept EMTs performing emergency medical services. You don't have to consent to it. They can just do it. The other area where the state is allowed to override your individual decision is the involuntary committal process. So that's a mental health process. If you are in need of mental health services and you're refusing those, there is a process by which the state of Georgia can compel you to go into treatment. We also have this nifty little law, OCGA 3192, which is the law that says these are the people who are allowed to consent to medical treatment. And this is where it even says, you yourself are allowed to consent to your own medical treatment. But then it adds other people. If you're not able to do it, your spouse can do it for you. And then if your spouse is unable to do it for you, then your adult children or parents or adult siblings. And there's no real priority in that mix right there. So if we have disagreement there, it can be problematic. But a lot of medical professionals don't like relying on this. Simply because it seems as though this is only good for emergency situations. So if we're talking about long-term or chronic type decisions, this law probably won't help you very much. All right. So we then have the adult guardianship and conservatorship process. This is the court process by which we gain control over the decision-making of someone else. There is an emergency process for this, and there's a non-emergency process for it. The emergency process, it takes about 7 days to get that. And it's only good for 60 days. It's pretty expensive. The court has a higher level of scrutiny on these cases, meaning you've got to prove that this truly is an emergency, not just a terrible inconvenience. Inside this emergency process, there's also the emergency process, where you can go into court and that same day walk out with a temporary person who can make decisions. This is where, when we have the person in a coma who's about to lose their leg, doctors need consent to do something, we have no other way to make the consent, we run to court, we get this emergency petition. I have been practicing in this area 14 years. I've only succeeded with that one time. So that's a very difficult standard to meet. And then there's the non-emergency process, which is the one that's mostly used. This is the one that gives you the permanent letters of guardianship, so it doesn't expire after 60 days, but it takes about 8 to 12 weeks to get this, and it is a true hassle. So guardianship in Georgia is needed when we have a person, we call that person the proposed ward, who cannot make or communicate significant responsible decisions concerning their health, safety, and welfare, and there is no other alternative. to make those decisions. So if there is a power of attorney in place and it's working, the court will not hear the guardianship case. But if there is a power of attorney in place but it's not working, the doctors aren't accepting it, the insurance company's not accepting it, then the court will hear the case. Conservatorship is essentially the same thing as guardianship, except it's only dealing with the finances. And it disappeared. There it is. So this is when the proposed ward cannot make or communicate significant responsible decisions concerning their property, and they have property, and there is no other alternative. So if there are no assets, we don't need to worry about conservatorship. Or if we have a durable financial power of attorney that's working, we don't need to do a conservatorship. Now, this court process can be initiated by any interested person, meaning you don't have to have a special relationship to this person to start this process. Generally speaking, though, it is started by usually a family member, sometimes a good close friend, sometimes, you know, I did one where I was appointed to a case and the criminal defense attorney filed the petition. His client happened to be sitting in the DeKalb County Jail. And so I was appointed to this case. I went to the DeKalb County Jail, first time I've ever been there, thank you. And I am confronted with this 90-year-old man who cannot communicate. He's wheelchair bound. He should not have been sitting in jail. But because he hit his significant other with his cane on the head, he was arrested, and DeKalb County police took him to jail, and his criminal defense attorney, he did not communicate verbally with anybody. He didn't make any communication. So clearly the criminal defense attorney needed somebody to tell him, what am I supposed to do? And so he had to file with the probate court, but he did not want to be the guardian, but he initiated the process. Fortunately, we were able to get that guy moved into a skilled nursing facility. I have no idea what happened with the criminal case, but I mean, that was just ridiculous. When you file a petition for guardianship, you must have either two petitioners, so that means two people who know that this person needs a guardian to sign the petition, or one petitioner and a doctor's affidavit where the doctor is saying this person needs a guardian. Once it's filed, the court will appoint an attorney to represent the proposed ward. So the person with the incapacity will have an attorney. You may not, but they will. The court also appoints an evaluator to do an independent evaluation. The court is not simply going to rely on the doctor you found to say this person's incapacitated, because you may have gone doctor shopping to find one that will say that what you want them to say. So the court has independent evaluators that will come out and do their own independent evaluation. It's a very extensive, exhaustive, maybe last 15 minutes examination, if that. Usually they're just coming to visit the person, see is what is detailed in the petition, what I'm actually seeing when I meet the person. Because, you know, I've gotten great phone calls. Husband calls me and says, hey, you know, I need to do a guardianship for my wife. I'm like, okay. You know, and I start asking questions. And it's all about, you know, she's not making the right decisions. She's making bad decisions. And I keep probing and probing. And then finally I get to the bottom of it. And I said, well, she wants to file a divorce. And I thought, your first instinct was to call an attorney to get guardianship over her? And I thought, maybe she should get that divorce. you know, so the court, this is a way people take control of other people's assets. You know, that's the primary area where people abuse this process, is to get at that Social Security money, to get at whatever finances they might have. This is the process used to do it. And so the court is very suspicious about every petition that gets filed. And it's not you, it is the process. The court does look to any guardianship designations. For instance, in that healthcare power of attorney we talked about, that advanced director for healthcare, there's a section in there where you can nominate, okay, You can nominate people to make decisions for you, to be that guardian. And if you've done that, the court will look to that. But it is the court that determines who is the suitable person to serve as the guardian. Now, when you file, whoops, my slides keep bouncing around. When you file a guardianship, you are the one that has the burden of proof. The assumption is this person doesn't need a guardian. So you have to prove with what's called clear and convincing evidence that this person needs a guardian. That can be a challenge. And that's why having those advanced guardianship things, the advanced directive for healthcare, if you can avoid having to do this, it's going to save a lot of aggravation and a lot of money. Conservators have to post a bond, and if you can't be bonded, you can't even apply for conservatorship. So if you have bad credit or for some other reason can't be bonded, the court will not appoint you. And in fact, the court may appoint the county conservator, which they're a lot of fun to deal with. Once you get, you know, go through the hearing and the court does grant the guardianship, you take an oath, and then the court issues things called letters of guardianship. That is your authority to act on this person's behalf. So that's what you give to the doctors, you give to the hospitals, you give to the insurance companies a copy of that so that they know you are the person empowered to make decisions. But hopefully you never get here. Hopefully you have those powers of attorney that will work. And like when I said that powers of attorney don't have to be honored, we usually only see that in financial institutions. Usually the medical community is very happy to see powers of attorney, those advanced directive for healthcare is in place. Insurance companies and hospitals don't have a problem with it either. So guardians and conservators have responsibilities. And I'm gonna try to get them up there quickly. You must be available to the ward, you must act in their best interest, and you have to file the court reports. If you're gonna go through this process, you do have duties. You've got to comply with those duties. You have to use your ward's resources for their own benefit. You don't get to take their money and buy a lake house. Actual case here in Georgia. And you have to inform the court of conflicts of interest. Here are the rights that are taken away when you do a guardianship. The right to enter into marriage. If the person is already married, it does not affect that. It's just they're not allowed to get married. The right to enter into contract. And I've actually had parents try to file that to prevent their kids who were over the age of 18 from getting married. And it's like, no, not gonna work. The right to enter into contracts. This is an important one. If you have someone who's mentally declining and they're, you know, hiring people to redo the roof, repave the driveway, you know, buying things that they shouldn't be buying, this is how you start preventing that. Actually, I have a great story, but I'm running out of time, so. The right to determine where to live and the right to consent to treatment. And that's the big one, that the guardian is empowered with the right to consent to treatment. Now, the right's not taken away. We're gonna talk briefly about a revocable living trust. It's a very powerful asset management tool. You need to consider that if you have the right kind of assets. This will allow you to manage assets without court supervision. The financial institutions must accept it. So if they don't, you can actually sue them. But the downside to this is you have to have the appropriate assets. If you don't have the right kind of assets, a revocable living trust will not help you. For additional information, in order to find the advanced directive for healthcare, I put the actual website up there. It's that little blurry line underneath that line from Google. Easier, just Google Georgia Advanced Directive for Healthcare, and then the DHR website usually comes up number one or two. That's the easiest to use of those. And then if you actually need to do a guardianship, gaprobate.org is the probate judge's website, and they have the forms there that you would complete in order to file the guardianship. And then on our website, we have lots of information. We have videos where I spend about an hour and a half explaining it. I actually have one set of videos with one of the probate judges. So it's always interesting to hear the probate judge's view of when you file. So I think now I'm supposed to take questions.
And who wants to start? He's got one started there.
How does a military power of attorney fit into this mold?
Military powers of attorney will follow whatever state the power of attorney is being presented in. So if you're presenting that power of attorney in a state where they're required to accept it, it will be accepted. In Georgia, they're not required to accept it, but for the most part, we haven't seen a whole lot of problems with it being accepted, but my guess is it all depends on what's the transaction you're trying to do. Now, if that military power of attorney specifically addresses healthcare decisions, it should be accepted here in Georgia.
My deceased fiance had a will and power of attorney. And some of the things I tried to handle, they did not accept the power of attorney. And once the person is deceased, does it become null and void?
Great question. So here's an actual example where someone had a power of attorney, tried to use it, it wasn't accepted. Then, you know, you either argue with them, you figure some other way around it, or you go to court. But what happens to a power of attorney when you pass away? Power of attorney actually terminates. Powers of attorney do not continue beyond death. And that's where then the estate has to be opened, and then the estate has the authority. So whoever, generally we refer to that person as the executor. Another term that's used for that position is called the personal representative of the estate. Has the authority to act on behalf of the estate then. Good question.
All the way in the very back.
I have a question insofar as the corpus of the guardianship. Would it operate the same way as an irrevocable power of attorney or irrevocable trust in that the assets would not be subject to Medicare or Medicaid or lawsuits?
Good question, and the answer is no. In fact, even under a power of attorney, it's not protecting those assets from being counted as an available resource for resource counting purposes for Medicaid. In order to protect that, you need to use a special needs trust. And that's an area that my partner and I, we do a ton of work in. That's probably 90% of our business. Those assets have to be transferred into an irrevocable Medicaid qualifying trust so it meets the specific requirements of what Medicaid is looking for. And that will all depend on where did that money come from. So if the money that's going into this trust originated with the person who's now applying for Medicaid, that has to go into what's called a D4A special needs trust. And that trust is subject to payback. So if that person passes away, Medicaid will have a lien against the value of that trust up to the value that Medicaid provided services to that person. So that an ordinary trust, even an irrevocable trust, is not sufficient to protect it from the claims of Medicaid and even most creditors in Georgia. Medicare never gets a claim against those assets. Now, there is something called a Medicare set-aside, which may have occurred if you had a lawsuit settlement. There is something required called a Medicare set-aside. But Medicaid is the one that can claim, has a lien.
Okay, my question, I have property in two different states. So do I need to have the same information in both states, the trust?
Generally, we only need to do the estate planning in the state you are domiciled. So whichever state you consider your home. Now, a probate would have to be opened in the other state when that time occurred. when you pass away, or you can use a revocable living trust if that property in the other state can actually be transferred into the trust while you're alive, and that will actually avoid having to file probate in that other state. Now, if you live, let's say, 50% of the time here, 50% of the time there, so you don't clearly have a domicile, I would probably suggest having at least the powers of attorney for each state, but those powers of attorney need to recognize there are other powers of attorney out there, and I'm not revoking those powers of attorney. Because usually when you sign a new power of attorney, you revoke all your prior powers of attorney. So the only one that would actually be valid would be the last one you signed, unless the power of attorney specifically says, I've done one of these for Georgia as well as Florida, and I intend both of them to be valid. So
he's going to hold it.
Someone probably needs to hold it for me, too.
The Georgia law related to advance directives for health care, the language sounds like it's pretty broad-stroked and not very specific, like do not intubate, no CPR, that kind of thing. And I'm wondering how that can be designated for somebody. And I've had patients come in when I was actively nursing that had advanced directives, and EMS was called, and they would come to the house and intubate, and patient was having CPR on the way to the ER, and they didn't intend for that to be. So how do you protect for things like
that?
That's
a great question, which we don't have a good answer for. I would like to tattoo across my chest, do not resuscitate. It doesn't matter. The EMTs are allowed to assume you want them to do it. The advanced directive for healthcare is different from a DNR. A DNR order is signed by a doctor. Now, if that particular patient had a DNR in place, usually it's tacked to the front door, or there's some kind of sign on the front door, and then the document is like on a magnet on the refrigerator or something, to warn, to let the EMTs know, do not resuscitate. But that's the only way to do that in Georgia. My understanding of the law is you can even tattoo across your chest, do not resuscitate, and the EMTs can ignore that. You can have a little wristband that has, call this number and they'll tell you, don't resuscitate. They don't even need to look at that.
Does Georgia honor the Yellow Dot program?
I'm sorry?
The Yellow Dot program?
Since I've not heard of that, I'm not even sure what that is. So I don't know if I can answer that.
Everybody gonna wait. We're gonna try to get around the room. We're gonna have 30 minutes of doing this. So ask short questions and we could get short answers. I know that.
I have three beneficiaries, but I'm going to get married next year. I don't want to not include him as my spouse. But then again, I would like to give most of my money to my niece. She's only 8 years old now.
Okay, lots of issues there. First off, certain life events necessitating redoing your estate planning. Marriage is one of those life events. Unless you do a will that specifically says, this will is being done in anticipation of getting married, and I want this will to be my will whether I am married or not, the fact that you get married may invalidate your will. And then you have no will. And then the state of Georgia will tell you what will happen with your estate. So after you get married, or shortly before you get married, you need to redo your will. And in it, you can include your new spouse and make the provisions that you would like for your other beneficiaries. And if you have a minor beneficiary, a beneficiary under the age of 18, you will always want to leave that to them in some form of what's called a testamentary trust. Otherwise what will happen is that minor child will have the money, but they can't have it legally, so the court has to appoint a conservator, until that child turns 18. And then on the 18th birthday, the court will hand that child all the money and say, do the right thing with it. And the sorority or fraternity will enjoy a nice weekend in Cancun, and that will be the end of your money. So, but a trust can be created. You name who you want to be the trustee of that. They'll manage the assets for that child, and it can be used. You can lay out the rules however you want, but typically it's for their health, education, maintenance, and support, which is exactly the opposite of what a special needs trust can do. So if you have a special needs beneficiary, you don't want to include that language. Back there.
My question had to do with respect to conservatorship of the person and the estate. I know in some states, particularly California, if you apply for letters of conservatorship and the person is, let's say, mentally incapacitated, for example, I was given conservatorship over my sister because she had suffered from strokes and she was not mentally able to do anything for herself. And the way I was able to get it without any problem was that I went before the court and I took her with me before the judge, and the judge asked her questions and she couldn't answer those questions. So my question, and as a result of that, I was awarded the letters of conservatorship. But my question here is, do they do that here in the state of Georgia? If a person is mentally incapacitated, they cannot speak for themselves with any type of logic. If I desire to get conservatorship or guardianship, or have whatever you want to say here, will the judge look at that person in front of the bench and ask questions and then give you the letters?
In the presentation, I said you have to present clear and convincing evidence that this person needs a guardian. Very frequently, the easiest way to do that is bring that person to court with you. Let the judge meet that person, interact with that person, and then the judge hopefully will be able to clearly say, yes, this person needs a guardian. So yes, and in fact, in Georgia, the reason we have an attorney that is appointed to represent that person, that attorney is the only one who can say the ward does not have to come to court. Otherwise, the ward has to come to court. And that rule is very well enforced. In fact, many of the judges will actually go to the hospital and hold the hearing in the hospital because the ward has the right to participate in that hearing. So I've done lots of cases over at Georgia Regional, which is our local big mental health facility. I've done it in skilled nursing facilities. So yes, good point.
I had my will, my power of attorney, all this fun stuff done about 15 years ago. Do they ever expire, or is that still valid for as long as I live in the state of Georgia?
Generally speaking, they do not expire unless the document has an expiration date in it. Because I do know both in our financial power of attorney and in the healthcare power of attorney, there is a place where if you wanted to, you could put an expiration date in it. Or certain life events could invalidate those things, such as a divorce, a death, things like that.
Repeat her question, please.
The question was, do they need to be specifically, and I'm not sure who the they is, each item. Generally speaking, it's valid until it expires. And so usually the event that causes the expiration has to be listed. But 15 years old, I do know tax laws have changed significantly. And so you may have tax planning in there that is not necessary anymore, but if it's in there, we still have to follow it. And so it's going to cause problems for whoever has to deal with it. Also, you may be surprised at who you've got listed in there. So I would take it out, look at it, and say, is there anything I need to change here? But generally speaking, no, it would not expire. Wills, you can probate a 40-year-old will. It's still a will, so...
Okay, I think I have a probably a silly question, but For those who are not married, have no kids, didn't sign or do any of these things, advance directive, what happens if you go to the hospital and you're on the verge of dying? Did they just let you die? If you do nothing.
It's a difficult question, actually. When we have people in the family circle, we kind of default to those people. But what if there is nobody in that? This is where the hospital might petition the probate court to say, hey, someone needs to make a decision for this person. We have nobody who can make a decision for that person. And so the court has to find somebody. And if the court can't find anybody, the Department of Aging becomes your guardian. And so the Department of Aging makes decisions for you. So if you are in that position, talk to friends, talk to acquaintances, and see if they would agree to be able to be that person for you, and then execute those documents. And I can promise you, the Department of Aging does not want to be your guardian. But that is the default. If nobody can do it, that's who the court has to appoint.
I just wanted to know, if you own property in multiple states, do you need documents in multiple states?
You need to have documents that can govern that property in multiple states. So let's say you just have a Georgia will and a Georgia power of attorney. As long as those documents meet the same requirements that, say, South Carolina has, generally speaking, South Carolina will recognize those documents.
Even though I own a house in South Carolina and a house in Georgia, and I want different things for different houses,
mm-hmm.
How would, you know...
Two ways. One, your will can say, I want this property to go here and this property to go there. If those properties are paid off, I would actually be recommending using a revocable living trust. Because number one, that doesn't go through court. If I use a will, it'll all go through probate. So we would have to open probate in Georgia and in South Carolina. Whereas if we use a revocable living trust, we don't have to open probate in either of those states for those particular pieces of property. So a revocable living trust is a very powerful tool if you have the right kind of assets. One of the right kind of assets is owning property. Owning property in multiple jurisdictions just furthers that goal of, hey, I can deal with this and the court never gets involved in it. A lot of people like to avoid probate. Probate in Georgia is not terribly difficult. So, you know, I hear horror stories out of other states. Florida apparently is a terrible state. California is pretty bad. But Georgia is not terrible, but it does take time. It is a hassle. And so some people just simply prefer, hey, there's a way to avoid probate. I'm going to take advantage of it. And a revocable living trust will allow you to do that. In the back.
Hi. My question is about the special needs trust. My parents have done their estate planning for my sister and I, and I'm just wondering, with the condition that I have, would it be to their benefit to have my portion in a special needs trust?
That's a great question, and that I'm going to answer it generally. If I could ask you some specific questions, I could answer it precisely, but I don't want to do that here. Generally speaking, a special needs trust is warranted if the person is on any kind of needs-based benefits. So we're talking SSI, not SSDI, but SSI and or Medicaid. So if you have either of those two benefits, we need to use a special needs trust. Now, we may want to use a trust regardless, because we want to have a way to manage and control those assets. And if mom and dad leave assets in a trust for you, your creditors can't touch the assets mom and dad left for you. So if you suddenly have very high medical bills and you may need to file bankruptcy at some point, the assets that are in the trust that mom and dad left for you are not part of the assets that are going to go through the bankruptcy. They will be protected for you if that trust is drafted properly. It can protect from your creditors. And if we're going to use a trust anyway, why not make it a special needs trust? Because you might need Medicaid nursing home in 30 or 40 years. And then this trust will not be counted as an available resource in determining whether you're eligible for that benefit. So is it needed? Maybe not. Is it advisable? Probably.
Hi, my question has a lot to do with what you just referred to with the special needs trust, but what is the look back period in this case? Let's say you set up that trust for Medicaid purposes. What is the look back period?
Good question. Currently in front of Congress is a bill to fix the D4A special needs trust provisions so that right now, the way the law is written, the only person who can create a D4A trust are the parents, the grandparents, the legal guardian, or by court order. What they're doing is they're introducing a bill to allow the person themselves to create that D4A trust. If that passes, which I believe it will, you yourself will be able to create your own D4A trust, transfer your assets into that D4A trust, and immediately be Medicaid eligible. The downside to the D4A trust, though, is whatever is left in that trust when you pass away will first be used to reimburse Medicaid for whatever Medicaid paid on your behalf. So, but there is no look back period. Now, the look back period is more in the elder law planning. And there are gifting strategies which will allow you to gift assets away, but that waiting period is 5 years. And my partner does more of that. But you know, that might be something to explore. So,
okay, last question is going to be over here. But before we get to that, I got to remind everybody, in case you're leaving, your seminar evaluation forms, if you can complete them and leave them on the table or give it to the two ladies out by our registration table. And remember, the raffles are at the very, very end. So you may not want to leave, all right? And besides, you got to be there to listen to Kristie, who's coming up next too. All right, and a great video that she made that's going to start her program off. Okay, now the last question.
Okay, is it public record a person's power of attorney or executor? Does it vary like from state to state as to who that person is or executor?
So the question is when you do a power of attorney, is that filed in the public record somewhere? Yes and no. Georgia does not require powers of attorney to be filed with the court, the register, unless it's used to do like a real estate transaction. Certain UCC transactions do require that to be filed. And once it's filed, it is part of the public record. Another reason to file it is it might get lost. If it's filed with the court, we know, hey, we can always get a copy at the court. Also, if you're afraid someone else is going to try something, that's another reason to file it with the court. Some states do require all powers of attorney to be filed with courts. So, but that does vary state to state. So I want to thank you all very much, and I appreciate you listening to a lawyer after lunch.
And before Mark leaves, we want to give him a certificate as well, and thank you very much. Thank you. Maybe you'll hang that in your office, too. By the way, if you all think that you're going to have a lot more caregiver questions, I think that Mark will allow me to give out his email address so you could write to him directly. All right? Great. All right. I just put him on the spot with that. That's why he had to say yes, right? All right. So next, well, we're going to help Mark down first, if he can stand to get down. And next up, we're going to have Kristie Salerno. And in advance of Kristie, she made this great video years ago that it's like for you to see what it feels like, not for you because you have MS, but for others to see what it feels like to have MS. And it's weird because even when I was diagnosed long before she even made the video, with my own legs, when I was having bad leg problems, I used to feel like I was a duck waddling around, you know? Anybody ever feel like that? Well, when you watch this video, you're going to be really impressed what she put together for others of what it feels like to have MS. And then she's going to come up here and speak with you all.
These are my hands. These are my feet. This is my torso. And these are my legs. What's my problem? This. See, I don't look like I have multiple sclerosis, whatever MS is supposed to look like. But clearly, there is something wrong with me. Since I was a little girl, I dreamed of being a performer. I wanted to do it all. I wanted to act and sing, dance, write, direct. Even at 3 years old, I believed I was Wonder Woman.
Now I know, hit a fork in the road, but I'll choose my path. Look straight ahead, and I'll never turn back.
Finding out I had MS was like a power outage. The spotlight went dark. I was in the prime of my life, just beginning my future, and I couldn't understand why this was happening to me. The stage was where I felt most comfortable because I was able to slip into the skin of someone else. And it was my role as an actress and as a musician to help my audience to understand and to feel what the character was going through, their struggles and their obstacles and their triumphs. But life cast me in my most challenging role as a person living with MS. But this time I couldn't slip the costume off. MS can be a really confusing disease, not only to those of us living with it, but I think more so to the people on the outside because they can't see what we are dealing with on the inside. Invisible symptoms are difficult to see. And I wish I had a dollar for every time somebody said to me, "You have MS, but you look so good." I think it's probably time that we bring the MS show on the road. Ooh, my favorite thing, escalators. I can't believe I'm in the mall right now, but it's a challenge for those of us with MS. Fast paced, lots of movement, balance issues, but it's for a good cause, so I'm gonna brave it. My name is Kristie, you are?
Rosalind.
Rosalind. I'm Nick.
And Nick, have you guys ever heard of multiple sclerosis?
I've heard of it before, but I don't remember what it is.
I think it's some kind of muscle disease.
Do you feel like you're in school right now?
A little bit.
A little bit? It's actually a disease of the central nervous system. So what part of the body do you think that affects? Actually, there's a lot of invisible symptoms. You want to guess at some that I have right now?
Being too attractive. I don't know.
Like Michael a lot. Shh, don't say anything because my husband's over there. But
numbness in the legs, weakness in the legs, getting tired easily, getting overheated easily.
This guy knows his stuff. My feet are totally numb right now.
Okay.
And I also have something called spasticity, and it's a tightening around my abdomen. It almost feels like I have a belt on. Do you think it would be surprising if I told you that I had multiple sclerosis?
Really?
I do.
Wow.
Yeah. Would you be willing to slip into the skin a little bit of somebody with MS.
Okay.
All right. We call it slipping into the MS costume. She's going to slip into my costume for a little bit.
The whole costume?
Well, I mean, do you like what I'm wearing? Is that okay with you? Do you have any choice of symptoms that you want?
Well, I guess you didn't really have a choice, so might as well just do whatever.
She is so smart. How does that feel?
Could it be tighter?
It could be tighter, but I shouldn't have said that.
All right, here comes Ty. He's very brave, and he's coming with a little bit of MS, drop foot, and some weakness in balance. How you doing, Ty?
Feels weird.
Our next person is going to have a little bit of double vision. One thing that some people with MS have is optic neuritis.
Do you see like this? I can't see anything.
What people sometimes say to me is that I have MS, but I look so good. And I have to say, you look so good. Like, look right at the camera and show them how good you look. Ooh.
I just didn't know that much about it. What people actually are going through.
Bring me the cure, Michael. Bring me the cure.
I can't even see the cure.
I think she wanted to take these home. So here I am at Hartsfield-Jackson Airport, busiest airport in the world, where over 85 million travelers pass through here each year. That means that out of those passengers, 114,000 people are people living with MS, just like me. I'm glad you wore socks and there's no holes in them. Your mom would be proud.
I'm putting on high heels right now.
I don't think mom would be proud of that one.
People look at you and say, oh, you're a picture of health. But they don't know what you feel on the inside.
Belt, shoe, flipper, weight, optic neuritis.
I can't really breathe. Kind of like my wedding dress, I guess.
Except you knew the dress was going to come off eventually,
yes.
Right?
I can't feel the buttons. I can't feel the shirt.
Oh, that's what you look like.
I got one.
I don't know if you noticed, but you didn't get the right one, though. You skipped a button.
Okay.
Any advice that you give people living with MS for dealing with all this?
I don't know if I have any advice. I don't think I do. I don't have no advice. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I feel so terrible because you feel terrible, and I hate that we just put you through this. All right, I'm going to let you go back there.
Okay.
And
change?
Yes.
But you can't change, and that's why I feel bad.
Aww.
Can I give you a hug?
Yes, you can. Hopefully, we'll find a cure for the disease one day. I don't think that it's a coincidence that the word dreams ends with an M and an S. But I also think that our dreams don't have to end just because we have MS. I hope that I get to do an encore production in a couple of years, and it'll be entitled MS Cured. Destinations, my story untold.
So everybody, now I'm going to introduce you to Kristie Salerno, the producer of that video, and I've known Kristie a long time, and I would like her to come and speak with you all today about her journey with multiple sclerosis.
If you're interested in sharing that video, it's available on YouTube. It's called The Show Must Go On, so if you put that in, or put in my name, or multiple sclerosis, it'll come up, and you can forward it and share it with whoever you like. So thank you, Stu, for inviting me to be here. And thank you really to all of you guys. I think a lot of people maybe don't understand what it takes for those of us with MS sometimes to get out, you know, and it's not as easy as just, you know, grab your keys and go out the door. I mean, there's a lot of preparation and thought processes and planning that go into place for those of us with MS. So I commend you all for being here. And obviously, it shows that you guys want to learn a little bit more. And while I will be sharing my journey with MS, really, I'm hoping to provide a reminder to all of us, me included, that MS doesn't mean that we have to stop living. And I really hope that while Dr. Thrower talked about a lot of great options for medication for MS, I hope to provide some medication for our souls, really. So I'm going to start at the beginning, not all the way at the beginning, because that would involve telling you guys the story about how I was almost born in a toilet, true story. But it has nothing to do with multiple sclerosis, so I'm going to skip that. It is a good story, though. But I'll start back in the beginning of my childhood dreams. You know, I often hear people talk about, you know, when they're little, what do they dream of doing? I want to be a teacher. I want to be a doctor. I want to be a nurse. I knew exactly what I wanted to do, too. Just a few things. I wanted to be a singer, a writer, an actor, a producer, a director, Wonder Woman, and a mother. Not necessarily in that order, but I started with working on Wonder Woman first. And I remember I used to put on my Wonder Woman underoos. Anybody here have or used to have Wonder Woman underoos? I was thinking about Dr. Thrower, and you know how he likes to dress up in costumes? I think this Halloween he should be Wonder Woman. So, you know, let's spread that around and see if we can get Dr. Thrower to do that. But at that really early age, I idolized Wonder Woman, and I really did believe that I was her. You know, I thought I had superpowers and that I could accomplish anything, and nothing was going to stop me from doing that. And so at that early age, I think around 4 years old, I started performing. I did dance recitals and acted in musicals, took voice lessons, never knowing, obviously, in those early years that all of that performance training was really setting me up to take on the biggest role that I would take on in my life. I decided really my life plan that I wanted to be on Broadway. I loved performing. And the interesting thing is about performing, it wasn't about being in front of an audience. For me, it was about connecting with the audience. And I started at Syracuse University studying musical theater. And that, in fact, is when I first started getting my symptoms of MS. I started to have weakness on my left side, and dancing had always come easy to me, but I started to notice that my left leg would get really weak and my knee didn't feel like it was attached to the rest of me. And I remember giving myself a lot of excuses on what was happening, you know. I thought, well, maybe I'm not eating right, not getting enough rest, just working too hard. I gave myself multiple reasons. And it was a frustrating time because I didn't understand what was happening. And being a college student, you know, I didn't think to seek out answers. I just tried to muddle through. And I did pretty well with that. I did end up graduating from Syracuse. And I thought, finally, my Wonder Woman life is about to begin, right? Nope. After graduation, I started to notice a lot of overwhelming fatigue, and I started to have this, my upbeat personality just wasn't upbeat anymore. I felt tired all the time, and I was sad, and that really wasn't me. I obviously now know that that was the beginning of depression, but I just really didn't recognize myself anymore. I remember thinking maybe all those years acting as multiple characters was giving me multiple personalities, because that's how I felt, like not even in control of my emotions. So I suddenly made a decision that I no longer wanted to be on stage. Not only did I not want to be on stage, I didn't even want to be in front of people. I just felt really awkward and uncomfortable, and I really went inside myself. So rather than begin my career in New York City as planned, I instead escaped down here to Atlanta. And I got myself a real job, I like to put it in air quotes. I was working in public relations and marketing, and in event planning, and I really liked it, I enjoyed it. And I learned a lot in that job, but deep down inside, I felt like I wasn't doing what I had dreamed of. You know, since I was a little girl, I felt like I was giving up on all of my childhood dreams. And I remember one night after coming home from work, I actually wrote down some things in my journal. Anybody here keep a journal?
Good for you. Okay, well, that's a first homework assignment to all of you who didn't raise your hand. Get a journal and start keeping track of things. You really, I think the coolest part about that is to look back afterwards and to see where you were and to see where you are. So for me, it was like an attempt to rekindle my Wonder Woman spirit. And I remember writing down a list of all the things that I hope to accomplish in my lifetime. One of those things was marrying my high school sweetheart, Mike, performing, maybe on Broadway, having children, but most importantly, not just having them, but raising them to be kind and hardworking and responsible, loving individuals. And the very last thing I wrote in my journal perhaps was the most self-fulfilling prophecy. I wrote, to use the talents and gifts I've been given to reach out and touch those around me in a positive light. What's so ironic is that a short time after writing that, I received a call for an audition, and I was hired to do a 10-month educational theater tour. So it was almost like the spotlight didn't want to leave me, even though I abandoned it. It was beckoning me back in. So I took the job. It was not Broadway, but I was back to doing everything that I loved, you know, acting and singing and dancing and working with kids. And on the very last day of 1998, my high school sweetheart did propose to me, and we started planning a wedding. Anyone here ever plan a wedding? Okay, so you know, it's a little bit stressful. And I started to notice that the stress was doing really weird things to me physically. I mean, it first started with some numbness and tingling in my fingers, and the same thing went down to my feet. And I remember my feet getting really, really cold. My first thought was, is that the cold feet that people are always talking about? It was so weird. And then I remember a few days later, my legs feeling really, really heavy. I mean, it almost felt like on one side I was dragging something along. Was that the ball and chain that people are always talking about, right? I mean, it was bizarre. And I ignored those symptoms. And I also got this tight, tight squeezing feeling around my abdomen. I've since learned people describe it as an MS hug. I don't know who those people are hugging, but a hug usually feels good, and this did not feel good. It was like this tight squeezing that almost felt like I imagine Linda Carter probably felt when she would put on that Wonder Woman bustier, you know, just. But again, I ignored that as well. And a few weeks after all those initial symptoms, something happened to me that I definitely could not ignore. I woke up one morning and I was unable to move the lower portion of my body. And suddenly the woo, blissful, you know, thoughts about walking down the aisle were suddenly replaced with, how am I even gonna be able to walk across this room? And it was petrifying. I mean, there's really no other word. There's nothing that can describe it. I mean, those of you who've had something similar, you know what I'm trying to say. But it was very scary, and my fiance took me to the doctor, and the doctor sent me on to the hospital where I had my first MRI. Do you guys remember your first MRIs? Fun. It was a surreal experience. I just remember feeling so isolated. You know, you're stuffed in this dark tube. I had to be perfectly still. I couldn't communicate. I couldn't speak. You can't move. You can't feel the comfort of somebody holding your hand. And I remember thinking to myself, was this what my future was going to be like? You know, when the neurologist delivered a diagnosis of multiple sclerosis, it felt like just how I told you in the video. It felt like the spotlight went dark, and suddenly my years of being Wonder Woman turned into I became the woman who wondered. And the question I wondered was, why me? It really felt like at that point that the curtain had closed and I wasn't even going to get to take a final bow. Shortly after the diagnosis, of course, I had that uncomfortable and sad conversation with my fiance, telling him he didn't have to stay with me because this was my path, and he would not just be marrying me, but he'd be marrying me with MS. But amazingly, he did not walk away.
So we set our I do's several months later, and the in sickness and in health part really left a lump in my throat. I felt so much remorse, really, for placing a burden on him. It was a lifetime for caring for me. And those feelings of facing that burden, a lot of feelings of guilt, it really drove me into deep denial. That moment was determined to bear the burden of MS on my own. So for the next few years, I did really the only thing that felt natural to me. I acted. Not on stage, but in every day of my life. I tried to pretend I was all right. I hid symptoms from my family and my friends. I avoided being around people, and I got pretty good at performing. I mean, after all, I was an actress, right? But the interesting thing is that true acting is not about pretending. It's really about being honest and being true to your character. And the key to a good performance is really finding your purpose and your intention in each scene. Well, as time went on, I lost touch with my true character. I was so focused on denying and hiding my symptoms that I forgot really about my own dreams and aspirations. And the more I was pretending that I was okay, the less I even knew who I was anymore. I remember a really pivotal moment coming when Mike and I were at a friend's house playing cards, and we were having a really good time, but I got tired more quickly than everybody else, and I decided I would walk home on my own. It was just around the block. And on the way, I just suddenly went numb on my left side and collapsed on the sidewalk. And you'd think, you know, I was lying there struggling to get back up, and you'd think I would be scared in that moment, and I'd be like, what's going on? No. You know when you're vain, when you have a fall like that, and all I kept thinking of, did anyone see me? I mean, this was about 1 o'clock in the morning, and I'm like, did anyone see me? How did I look when I fell? And so instead of, you know, being logical, I'm worried about who saw me, and did they think I had one too many drinks? But I did make my way back home, and the next morning I had some bruises and some scrapes, and I just kind of tried to brush it off. And I remember Mike not allowing me to brush it off anymore. He was done with me trying to pretend that nothing was wrong. And so it was time that I went back to the doctor, and I went to see several doctors. Sure, it'd be nice to tell you that the reason why I kept going was so that I could find the right doctor, right? And I could find somebody I really gelled with and the best professional opinion I could get. But the truth is, I went to several doctors because I was hoping for a different diagnosis. I was hoping that somebody would say, oh, the other ones were wrong. No, you're fine. But that isn't what happened. Each time I got to hear the same diagnosis one after another, and it was confirmed that I had multiple sclerosis. And this time I was told that they found more lesions, several black holes, and it really, in that very moment, was like my lifelong dreams had died, and I certainly didn't feel like Wonder Woman. I didn't feel like I had the superpowers anymore. I really felt powerless. I just kept thinking, how could this happen to me? It wasn't part of my life plan. It certainly didn't fit into any of my dreams. I think one of the best things I've ever done is write a letter to my MS. And if you haven't done that, well, then that's homework assignment number two. I had so much that I wanted to say to that monster. I remember my letter starting with frustrations. I had a lot of questions, of course, why me? And I really demanded answers. It was like, did I do something to cause this? What did I do to deserve to be imprisoned in my own body? And then I started to get really angry when I told my MS all it had done to me, all it had taken from me. You stole my confidence. You took my dreams and you mocked them. You dangled them just within reach, and just as I extended my hand out to grab them, you snatched them from my sight. When I'd start to feel just a tiny bit of bravery beginning to build up inside me, you spit in my face. You made me feel weak. You made me feel worthless. And you paralyzed me with fear. You filled me with worries of what ifs, and you left me afraid of even leaving my own home, afraid of my future. And of course, it wasn't very long until my letter turned to sadness. It felt like my heart was filling with emptiness, and as parts of my body, like my hands and my feet, went numb or my legs hardened, I realized it was not only affecting my limbs, but it was doing the exact same thing to my heart. MS was stealing my joy, and the only thing that was going to rescue me was me. I had to rediscover my passion. I had to find my purpose. My dreams were not going to stay in the dark anymore. Like I reference in the film, you know, the word dreams ends with an M and an S, but our dreams don't have to end because we have MS. They may look different, they may change, but they're still our dreams. So at that point in my letter writing, my inner Wonder Woman took over, and suddenly my MS letter turned into a thank you note. So thank you, MS. You have changed me. I will never be the same. Because of the challenges you've thrust at me, I have discovered my inner soul. I am stronger, wiser, more compassionate, humble, honest, driven, and very grateful. So in the 16 years of pain, uncertainty, fear, embarrassment, sadness, hurdles, setbacks, none of that is going to blind me from all my blessings. MS, you have opened my eyes and my heart to appreciate every second of this beautiful life I've been given. So I had a choice to make, right? I could be a victim of my circumstance, or I could choose to rediscover the Wonder Woman inside of me. I had MS. I couldn't change that, but I could change my perception. Playing victim wasn't my role. I was going to take center stage in the role that life cast me in. Life cast me as a person living with MS. It was the most challenging role I've ever taken on. That is until I decided that I needed still to make my biggest dream come true. I'd accomplished many of my professional dreams after my MS diagnosis. I wrote and recorded and produced my debut CD called Believe. Several of my songs hit the pop country roots radio charts, which was pretty exciting to be sandwiched between like Keith Urban and Martina McBride. I wrote and directed my short film that you guys just saw, The Show Must Go On. And really it was my husband that inspired that film, because there were so many times he would say, I don't understand what you mean. And so I'd say, go get the dish gloves and try on this pair of shoes. And he was my guinea pig. And actually the handsome man that's helping people get into the costume is my husband, in fact. And so I did that really to help other people. And then the last several years to be able traveling the country, talking and performing for other people affected by MS. But my biggest dream was becoming a mom, and it was pulling on my heart. I was not afraid of being a parent, but I was very afraid of being a parent with MS. And the decision to have a baby took the full support of my husband and my doctor. And we did a lot of planning. We created a plan. I like to say we planned for the worst, but we hoped for the best. And boy, did we ever get the best. Because in 2009, I gave birth to my healthy, precious baby boy, Kingston. He is an amazing blessing. He really is by far, and I tell him this all the time, and he thinks I'm teasing, but I mean this from the bottom of my heart. He is the best teacher I've ever had. Truly seeing the world through a child's eyes gives you perspective to what really matters. And also, you realize how much when kids come into this world, they're not jaded. They look at the world with everything's okay and nothing is impossible. And that's really what he has taught me. And my first year with Kingston was filled with a lot of challenges. I did a lot of face plants, but luckily it was just me. And I learned to plan a lot better as a parent with MS. Truthfully, adjusting to a new baby is tough for anybody, whether you have MS or not. But being a parent with MS has really taught me to not sweat the small stuff. You can't, because anxiety, stress, and worry plus MS equals a flare of my symptoms. And unfortunately, we don't get to choose which one of our symptoms we want to flare. Wouldn't that be nice, though, if we could? Maybe they can come up with something for that. But I realized what I could choose was to flick my inner switch of positivity. And really, our inner peace is a big piece of the puzzle of having MS. And I felt like when my inner peace wasn't in place, I couldn't see the total picture in front of me. And as I began to become more confident and secure in my role as a parent with MS, I decided that my total picture was not complete without a sibling for my son. So 3 years ago, I gave birth to my sweet, precious little Giabella. And she keeps us on our toes, on our heads. She keeps us spinning in circles, but I would not have it any other way. Our life with MS is definitely difficult at times, but it's not impossible. It brings a lot of uncertainties, but truthfully, so does life without MS, right? I really believe that life is a one-way ticket, but it is our perspective of the journey that determines if we enjoy the ride. And it's a roller coaster, right? It's filled with ups and downs. It's like this slow climb to get to the very top, only to take our breaths away, you know, as we plunge to the bottom. There's definitely good days, there's bad days. I know people often look at me and think, what does she know? She looks okay. She doesn't know about my MS. Well, many of us know that we live with a lot of invisible symptoms, but just because people can't see them on the outside doesn't mean that we don't feel them on the inside and that they don't affect us. You know, I just have to tell you, I've seen my fair share of dark days, dark weeks, months, even years. I've been knocked to the floor numerous times. I've been in a hospital bed, in a wheelchair, with a cane, all because of MS. And speaking of MS, let's talk about it. What is MS? I mean, we heard a lot of what MS means medically, but what is multiple sclerosis to those of us living with it? To many, the letters MS stand for multiple sclerosis. To me, when I was first diagnosed, I thought those letters stood for must stop. Must stop living, must stop dreaming, must stop planning for my future. But today, I want to share with you that I think the letters MS stand for Mighty Soul. I think that all of us with MS and those of us around us that are affected by our MS, we all have mighty souls. And MS may affect our bodies, but I'll tell you, there's one part of us that it will never touch, and that is our mighty souls. It's like, the best way I can describe MS is it's like a natural disaster, right? I mean, it's like a hurricane, a tornado, a tsunami. It comes without warning. It can make us feel like we're left with nothing. It's definitely a barrier to reaching our dreams, and it's filled with unforeseen challenges. Sometimes it can knock us off our feet, literally, right? Something that really gets to me is when I hear people say, he or she suffers from MS. I don't suffer from MS. I think there's a real big difference. There's a big difference between suffering and grieving. I refuse to suffer from MS. I had to tell myself, it's okay to grieve. It's okay to feel grief and temporarily grieve the loss of my life before MS, but I couldn't wallow in my pity party for too long, because I think if I did that, then my soul would be suffering in a soggy misery. My mighty soul needs to sing, needs to laugh, to create, to love. And it is truly my passion for people like yourself that always light my way out of the darkness. And speaking of the darkness, I really do believe that it is down in the darkness of the valley, not while standing on the peak, that we discover our true strength. I didn't choose to have MS, but I do believe that MS chose me. Bad choice, MS, because I'm Wonder Woman, right? But a wonderful thing to be able to stand up here and share with you all is that all of my dreams came true while living with MS. I'm not standing on a Broadway stage today, but I believe I am exactly where I'm meant to be. Everything I dreamed of accomplishing has come true, and now it's not about my dreams anymore. It's about the dreams of my 6-year-old son and my 3-year-old daughter. You know, just like live theater, life is unpredictable. Anything can happen, right? Uncertainty, embarrassing moments. I just want to impress upon all of you that it's okay for us to talk about those moments. I used to hide from that stuff. I don't hide anymore. I share it. I laugh about them sometimes because humor, as Dr. Thrower told us today, is an important part of coping with MS. Some days just feel like a comedy of errors, and it feels good to laugh. I think it's really important that we share our fears, our challenges with our loved ones and each other. And I think it's so, so very important to talk to your doctor. I'm so blessed to be able to call my doctor, not only a friend, but he is a member of our family. And the doctor-patient relationship is crucial to successfully living with MS, because if we don't provide them with what's going on in here, we're not giving them the total picture, and they can't give us the best option for care. One thing, you know, I've gone to 3 neurologists, and in my time with each of them, they were awesome. But the disease, as we know, changes. And my perspective of the disease changed, and what I wanted to do about it changed a little bit. So I needed to find somebody in line with me. I needed to be proactive about MS, not reactive. All the medications that we've heard about so far that are approved and that are working, right, those are to slow down MS. Some of them possibly to stop it. But there aren't medications yet to fix what's already been done. So that's why, for me personally, being proactive is so important. You know, I used to do a lot of denying symptoms, and it was just such a waste of time. It actually put me backwards. And I remember when I first started going to my current neurologist, he said, "My goal with you is to keep you as close to exactly how you are now when you walk into my door." And when I just saw him this past June, I was thrilled to be able to thank him, because not only has he done that in the past 7 years, but I am better than I was when I walked in his door. So again, what can we attribute that to? Maybe it's positivity, maybe it's medications, maybe it's God's will, I don't know, but it's been an amazing journey. I encourage each and every one of you to stay true to your character and to be the director of this crazy, unpredictable play with all of your passion, your strength, and your courage. I think you'll really be surprised at what you can accomplish. Just want to thank you all again for having me here today, and I truly wish you the best of luck in your starring roles. So thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Kristie. Don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere. They might have questions for you.
Oh, you might have questions.
Anybody
for
have questions for
I thought
Kristie?
It was autographs. No, I'm just kidding.
Does anybody have a question for Kristie? Ken, you've got 2 of them right there.
Crystal, I think you're wonderful. You made us cry. You made us laugh. And God bless you. You were wonderful.
Thank you so much. Now you're going to make me cry.
Hi. First of all, I'd like to let you know that you resonated with me when you were had the escalator in your video, because I actually fell down the escalator, and that was my determining factor. I didn't know I had MS till I fell down the escalator and followed through. So I understand. Secondly, just wanted to ask you feedback on positive thinking, anything that we could do, well, we, me, whatever, just to continue to have a positive spirit, because to your point, MS does get you down. I know it gets me down. What would you recommend, or just some things that may have worked for you?
I think that really, again, being honest with yourself. Like, if you're upset about something, a symptom happens, it keeps reoccurring, it's stopping you from enjoying something in your life. For me, sometimes it was even simple things like I wanted to be able to cook with my family, and I would get so winded and tired that I'd have to sit down, and it was so frustrating for me. And for a while in the beginning, I just kind of threw my hands up and I thought, well, I'm just not going to cook anymore. But instead it went back to the whole point about communicating with your doctor. I was able, having conversations with my doctor, to say, I can't do this and I want to do this. Is there anything in your arsenal that can possibly help me? I think that's been important. But I think the journaling, because sometimes if it's all up here, it just gets overwhelming. And I think if we can write it down and then take a moment and find something that brings you joy, something that you're passionate about. For me, it's music and it's being creative and writing. For a lot of people, you know, it is cooking, it's playing with their kids or their grandkids, it's being a part of a group. Just find what your personal passion is and pursuing it, because then suddenly the focus goes off of what's upsetting you and it goes into what makes you happy. And that's what we want to live our lives, to be happy, you know, not to exist. So does that help at all? Okay.
I just want to thank you for sharing your story. I had my 12-year anniversary on Tuesday, and to be here, I was in Shepherd Center 12 years ago today. I truly believe MS is my purpose, because that's how people know me, as a person who's overcome. Positive thinking is everything. And when there was somebody fatigued, even when sometimes I don't want to run, I run anyway, because it's mind over matter. I can beat this, and my nickname is Missy. But I thank you for sharing your story, because talking about it helps overcome it versus it always being in your head.
Okay, just a couple more.
This is going to sound lame.
They don't say it. You can't say it. No lame comments, everybody. No, I'm just kidding.
Good.
No, say it.
When I find that I get up and I'm supposed to be somewhere at 10 and it isn't going to happen because I'm whipped. And I don't know of a good, like, phrase, catchphrase, pet phrase to use to say, I'm tired, I'm having fatigue, how did you manage telling those people that think you look fine, and what's the problem?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, and I have to say it's something I still continue to struggle with, especially with my group of friends. I have the same group of 9-10 girlfriends since I was really young, and they see Kristie, you know, like the energetic. And so when we'd be all going out, like in the evenings, we have our girls' weekends and things like that, I'd get embarrassed, you know, when I couldn't quite keep up with all of them. But again, it just, you don't have to apologize, I think, for what's happening. Just say what it is, and don't make any apologies, really. I mean, it is what it is. It's not that you're lazy. And I think those, there's a great Dr. Seuss quote, those who matter don't mind, and those who mind don't matter, you know? And I think that's, the people who love us for us are going to understand, and it's not going to be a big deal to them if we're late. I mean, don't be late for your funeral, but, you know, I don't... actually, do be late. Sue's right. Be late for your funeral. I'm going to be late for my funeral. Mark my words. I'm going to make you all wait. But I don't think you have to constantly feel like you have to apologize for it. You know, somebody who has cancer, for instance, and goes for chemotherapy, we don't make them apologize for, oh, sorry, you know, sorry, don't have any hair, everybody. It's, you know what I mean? So I think it's kind of, it's perspective. what we put out there, I think those who love us will get that back. So if we say, I'm sorry, I'm late, it's just a lot to get out the door. And then you also have to, my husband helps me with this a lot too, is you don't want to get too long-winded about it. I'm sorry. I mean, this happened to me. I couldn't even get out of bed. And then when I got in the shower, and it's true. I mean, sometimes our event of the day is just taking a shower, right? I mean, that's like, yay, I got ready for the day. But if we start to go there, I would find myself staying in there. And so I think it's more putting positivity out there is more for yourself than it is for anybody else, really.
Thank you, Kristie. Don't run away. I got to give you your certificate that you've seen already. Where are you going? I've got to give you this. See, Kristie gets one, too.
I get a certificate. Thank you.
She gets an A. Thank you. Oh, wait. We're not ready for that yet. We're not ready for raffles yet.
Take a moment to take a look at the handsome gentleman in the back of the room and the little mini handsome gentleman in the back of the room and the little curly-haired blonde-haired girl.
Those are the ones I hear back there.
That's my family.
There's the family. How about that? So, you know, I believe what Christy's been saying, obviously I have, if all I'm doing is running around the country doing programs, right? I don't have time to think about my own MS, which is why I just like to just do and do and do, right? I mean, there are those in this room that have seen me just going forward and doing things all the time, and that's what we try to get everybody to understand is, yes, you have MS, but you don't have to live that you have MS. You can live your lives, and that's what we want to hope that you all do, and I hope that you all learn from what Kristie spoke about today, so thank you for that. Now, again, we want to thank the company that allowed us to do today's program, or we would not have had Dr. Thrower, Tracy Walker, Mark Biernath, or Kristie Salerno. And so let's give a round of applause to Genzyme. Thank you. And Mallinckrodt and Acorda. And so we always want to thank them all for doing what they're doing. Thank you.